close to done. Mostly done. Quiet class today, Shane. All right, so who's gonna be brave and who's gonna share some examples that they have? Anybody? Again, no right or wrong answers, go for it.
Good leadership skills.
Okay, and why would good leadership skills be important to an employer?
Because sometimes you'll be in an environment where you'll have to work with and, you know, sometimes manage other people, and having skills in order to be able to do that adequately, even when you first join a job, is going to make you very important.
Absolutely. Great. Other examples? Go for it.
I'm a very calm person.
Okay.
So that helps me in high pressure situations and whenever I have to handle crisis, because I can use self control so I can handle the situation much better than others.
Perfect. What else? All right, I know somebody's throw time management, organized, people person. I know there was on your list, so somebody throw them out there. Why are those important?
Helpful.
Okay.
So that helps me in working well with my colleagues and in the team. So that, I mean, it keeps the environment of the team very lively, and I'm good at even, basically I'm good at negotiating with people. So if my team is undergoing any negative kind of situation, I can help the people deal with it by mediating between them.
Perfect.
Go for it. I want to connect with first. Mm-hmm. Helpful, but I'm a really good manager. Keeping people on task and making sure that what the supervisor wanted to be done by the end of the day at a certain time, which is good. And if not, to notify them that it wasn't and what wasn't.
Great answer. What else? Anybody else feel brave enough want to share? No, you're fine. Go ahead.
Good listener.
Good listener. I was waiting for that one. That's pretty typical. All right. So tell me why being a great listener is important to an employer.
Because being a good listener, I don't miss out on small details.
Mm-hmm.
I listen to them very perfectly. And I'm always focused on what they are saying rather than what I want to say. So it helps me in keeping my details in check. And it reflects in my work, which has very minimal errors.
Perfect. All right, so this example, guys, is essentially me putting you through a basic, quick introductory to interviewing. Tell me about yourself, right? Because when we get to that part of the process, when we get to the interview, where we've gone through all these crazy steps to get to the interview, then they want to know the toughest question of all. Tell me about yourself. And the first thoughts running through our head is, well, what do you want to know? You want to know about my childhood? You want to know about teenage years? You want to know, you know, how I was rebellious? What do you want to know about me, right? And then right off the bat, that puts us into panic, anxiety, frustration, confusion, and all of that is written on your face and in your body language right at the beginning of the interview because we're nervous and we don't know what to say. So what we're doing is we're helping you practice and prepare for one of the most stressful pieces of this process is talking about you in a way that an employer is going to be excited and interested to know about you, okay? Because they've seen your resume, they know you're qualified to do the job, otherwise you wouldn't have gotten the call, but now they get to have to know you as a person, okay? And what they really want to know is, how are you going to benefit me? So what are your qualities? What are your skills? What are your abilities? And how is it going to benefit me in this job and this team and in this role? Because at that point in the process, they're really just trying to figure out who's going to be the best personal fit for our team. Because they know you can do the job. But we've already had a team established, right? With different personalities, different abilities, different weaknesses, okay? And now you're the new piece of the puzzle. They don't know you, but they have to get to know you because they have to work with you every day moving forward. So are you gonna benefit the team by being helpful? Are you gonna be on time? Are you gonna be able to manage and lead people well? You gotta be able to explain that to them. So that's why this exercise helps you prepare. Before you go to these stressful, confusing interviews, how are you going to talk about yourself? And what are some genuine character traits that you have that aren't just going to be, oh, this sounds good, I'm going to just say this, but I'm not going to be able to tell them why that's meaningful, okay? So what we just had you do is tell me about you and why is it meaningful and how is it going to benefit me as the employer? Does that make sense?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Good job, guys. I know I had to make you think for a little bit. I'm sorry. All right, so the other piece of that, as we said, is your attitude. Your attitude is going to impact your motivation and success through this process. Yes? Yeah. So essentially, they're going to start with, tell me about yourself. Tell me a little bit about you. And exactly what you did, you can say, I'm helpful, here's why. I'm great at leading people, here's why. And this is how. Okay? So what you're going to do is you're going to set it up kind of like a situational sort of response. Okay? So I'm going to tell you I'm X, Y, and Z. And you can use all three examples. You can use five examples, however many you feel comfortable describing about you as it relates to what they're going to need you to do. Okay? If they don't need you to lead and manage people, is that really a great character trait you want to bring up? Maybe not. Okay, but if it is part of what they're going to have you do as your role, then highlight that you're great at managing and leading people. Okay? If you're great at training people, talk about training people. If you're good at organizational skills, talk about that. Okay? So it's going back to, again, all these pieces connect. What does the job description say they're looking for? How does that really connect with you and who you are? Because you want to fill that role, right? So when they say, tell me about yourself, that's when you're going to start going back. Who are they looking for? Am I this person? And then let me describe to them that I am this person. Okay? And then you're going to say, I'm helpful. Exactly what you did when I said, why is that important? And you're going to explain to them why that's important. So you're explaining to them that you understand why those qualities are important to do that job. Both. Yep. You can incorporate both. Good question. All right, so as we said, we all understand this is pretty much a really long, stressful process, okay? So what we're trying to do is help break it up in easier pieces. Because most people, by the time you get to success, they haven't seen your struggle to get there, right? They haven't put in the time. They haven't put in the energy. They haven't seen you get your 12 no's before you got your yes. Okay, so a lot of times what we do is we judge people based on, oh, look, they made it. Or my peers already got a job before they got out of school and I'm not there yet. Your process, your journey is going to be very different from everybody else's, okay? So understand that while on the surface, there are going to be people out there who look like they just got it all together and they've got it instantaneously, you haven't seen their process, okay? There's typically more to the story than just immediate success, okay? So be patient, okay? And then understand that if you haven't gotten a full-time job or whatever your definition of success would be, whether it's even a part-time job or a summer job or whatever your, again, defined success is, you have to understand that the time that you would be doing that work, so let's say you want that 40-hour week full-time job, if you don't have that yet, this process of job searching should be equal to the same amount of time you'd be putting into work. So if you expect to work 40 hours a week, your process to getting that 40-hour week job should be almost equal. You should be doing interviews. You should be putting in applications. You should be going to networking events. You should be doing something to help your process along within that time frame. Okay? What most people do is they'll send out applications and resumes and then they wait. I tell people that's just casting a net and hoping that fish come. Okay? But you got to know what's the weather, what type of fish is there, is this a great season for fish, are you in the right body of water to fish? Okay, there's more to just throwing it out there and hoping for the best. Okay, so ideally I try to use the little quote of, I'm here to teach you how to fish, not just eat for the day. Okay. Okay, and ideally the more you practice at all these pieces of the process, the better you're going to be and the less stressful they're going to be as you have to kind of repeat them. Because most of us are not gonna get one job for the rest of our lives, right? Are we assuming that we got one thing that we're aiming for at this point, or are we just trying to get paid right now, right? Okay, so there's gonna be different pieces of your steps, there's gonna be different pieces of your process, and they're all gonna look a little different, okay? So you kind of have to just get used to practicing. Again, we're gonna hear a lot of no's before we get our yeses. So the better we practice, the more we get comfortable doing this, we're going to be pros. All right, so the other piece, now we're going to deal with exploration. So we have to look at actual job titles, because what we may think we're qualified to do, we might not actually be qualified to do. We have to consider the industry as a whole, okay? like we said, doctors and lawyers and business people and janitors and teachers and everybody, they have their own nuances, okay? It's not going to be the same for everybody in every industry. You have to take into consideration the types of jobs you want. Where are they located? Do you have to move? Okay, because that factors in the cost of living and new housing and transportation and travel and all these other things, right? What's your pay scale? If you are used to a certain lifestyle or you're expecting a certain pay and that job isn't within that pay scale, we might have to make some sacrifices somewhere, right? Or we may have to get more education or more training or whatever the situation may be, okay? We have to look through the types of jobs that are available again right now. If we really want that full-time job, but we're also in school and that's just not a reasonable thing we can do, maybe we need to take that part-time job or that seasonal job, okay? That's still gonna give us experience. It's gonna help us network with people who are maybe in our industry or maybe who can connect us to our industry, okay? So there's lots of events that you can explore. We always have on-campus jobs. We always have employers visiting us. We always have job postings on our online job board about what's available, okay? You can do some basic things called job shadowing or informational interviews. So maybe you have an idea of what you might want to do, but you haven't really been exposed to it yet, so you don't really know what that entails. You can connect with an employer. They'll let you come out and kind of take a student work day sort of setup, okay? You can go and you can kind of see what does their day-to-day look like. You can ask them those questions of, tell me what you do, tell me how you get there, what were your steps you had to take? So you can really start to gather that information before you invest time and energy and more money and more degrees that you may or may not want or need to get, right? We need to research the employers themselves, because right off the bat, Google's number one top company in the world, but does everybody want to work for Google? Okay, what is Google all about? How do they serve their community? What positions do they have available? Okay, there's a lot more to the fact that I'm a big, shiny, number one employer, but what does that really mean? And how does that really matter to you and what you're trying to do? Okay, because there's a lot of great opportunities and employers out there that a lot of people overlook. Okay, so a Waffle House, a Geico, something that we're just so used to seeing as common. But again, they have IT people. They have leadership people they need, right? They need engineers and actual labor people and tradesmen, and okay? Because there are all aspects of these businesses and roles they have to fill. Even welcome center front desk people, call center workers, okay? So wherever you're at with this whole process of I just need a job, expand where you're thinking you're searching, okay? And part of that, again, is doing your homework, gathering your information. How much money do you need to pay? Where is it going to be? All those big pieces of information. But while you're doing it, try to make personalized professional connections with people, okay? And you don't want to just do that with people who are going to be set in your trade, okay? If you want to be a lawyer, don't just make friends with a bunch of lawyers, okay? You're going to need other friends in your group. Because let's say 10 years from now, you don't want to be a lawyer. Let's say you want to go and be in IT. Do you know anybody in IT at this point? Nope, you only made lawyer friends. Who's going to help you? Who do you know that's going to help connect you with opportunities? At this point, you don't know anybody. You've got to start from scratch, right? But if right off the bat, you're just making connections with really cool people and different professionals, you never know how somewhere along the line, they're going to help you find a job or an opportunity, or you're going to connect them to a job or an opportunity, okay? So think outside the box of your network connections. All right, this preparation piece, again, depending on what you're looking for, that should be the number of hours that you're going to be putting into actually dealing with this process. And some of the ways that you prepare is exactly what you're doing, taking some of these classes, picking specific majors, working on these really intensive student projects, okay? These extracurricular activities, what clubs, what organizations, what affiliations, what community service projects you're doing, okay? Volunteer work, internships, all of this matters because that's gonna be the experience you highlight on your resumes and when you're talking about yourself in these interviews. So just sitting in a classroom and getting a degree does not make you the number one shiny star that an employer is looking for. I'm telling all of you right now, the degree is helpful, but what you do plus the degree is really what they're looking for, okay? So if you're not involved in anything outside of your class, I'm telling you right now, you need to find something to be involved in, because that's what they're looking for, okay? And even if it's something like, I'm just working at Chick-fil-A right now because that's all I can do with my schedule, that's fine, because those soft skills that you're gaining at Chick-fil-A are valuable to all employers across the board. Those foundational employee type nuances where you learn how to interact with people in a corporate type setting is important, okay? If you can adapt and deal with people, because there's not a single industry out here that doesn't involve some sort of involvement with another human being, if you don't have the skills to deal with people, you're not gonna be successful, right? So join those clubs, do that volunteer work, do something outside of just getting this degree. Because again, there's gonna be 30 of you with the same degree. What makes you special? Okay? Now, once we go through all that, again, we gotta make practical, smart goals of how we're gonna apply what we're trying to do. So if you need a job by December, we need to set this up. Okay, what are the specifics? How am I going to measure whether or not I've made my goal? Is this attainable and achievable, or am I sitting here reaching for the stars before I can even get up the first step? Okay, it's got to be a realistic goal that we're setting for ourselves. It's got to be relevant. If it doesn't connect to what you're trying to do, we got to start over. Okay, and you have to keep in mind time frames. Okay, don't plan for what you're going to do 10 years from now without doing the pieces of what are we going to do tomorrow? What are we going to do next week? What are we going to do a month from now to get us to what we're doing years from now, okay? Because if we can't get through these little steps, that end goal is nowhere in reach, okay? So this is why we gave you kind of the acronym of SMART. It's got to be specific. Give me as much detail as you can. I got to be able to measure that, yes, you've achieved that or not, okay? And again, it's got to be realistic, guys, okay? Let's see. With the goals, and as we're doing this preparation and as we're exploring information, really keep in mind, what type of environment do you want to be in? I notice that's a lot of key pieces that people miss. They're like, I need a paycheck, I need a job, this is great. But then you're in it and you may not really like the environment you're in. How many of you want to work in an office setting? How many of you want to work outside? How many of you want to work for a big corporation? How many want to be in a small nonprofit? Okay, you see, all of you had different answers. But it's important, because if I stick somebody who wants to work outside in a big office setting and behind a computer, probably in about a month or so, you're going to say, I'm done with this. I can't deal with this. Okay, so not only is it about what you're qualified to do, what teams you're going to be working with, but what's the overall environment you're going to be in, and how does that impact your personality and your success overall? Okay, because those things matter in the long run. Also looking for a way for you to have a work-life balance, okay? There are going to be things in life that you have to sacrifice in order to reach this work-life balance. It might be a pay scale. You might want to make over six figures, but you're going to be working 70 plus hours a week. When are you going to have time with your family and your friends and travel and all the other things you might want to do, right? There's going to be sacrifices to all of these pieces, but it's got to be things that you're willing and able to accept and live with or without, okay? Because the ultimate goal is trying to find this work-life balance. And always making sure that everything that you're putting into play has realistic expectations, okay? Don't put yourself in debt, okay? Don't destroy your families and your lives for jobs, okay? It really is a matter of doing what you love, doing what you're good at, being with people and in a place that you enjoy. I know all of you have heard the phrase, if you do what you love, it's not like working, okay? That's essentially what we're all kind of looking for, is I want to do something that I love to do, that I'm good at doing, with people that I like being with, And I can still go home at the end of the day and be with the people that I like being with and doing the things that I like to do. Okay? So that should also be in the back of your mind as you're trying to navigate through this process. And those are things that as you're doing this interview process, as you're searching for jobs, as you're doing for research in companies, they'll start to give you this information. If they're all about community service work and giving back and they're a family-oriented company, then guess what? That should tell you right there, what are their values? What are their priorities? Okay, if they're family-oriented and you have a family, then if you have to leave because your kid is sick, that shouldn't be an issue for them. But then there are going to be those companies where I expect you to be here on time, whether you're sick, they're sick, or doesn't matter. Okay, so getting to know what are they about and how well does that reflect with my work-life balance I'm trying to achieve. Okay? Now the practical piece most people don't like and why most of you come to see me, okay, is it's those resumes, it's those cover letters, it's those references and letters of recommendations and transcripts and LinkedIns and all those other things, right? How many of you have an updated resume? How many of you are ready to send them out and impress employers right now? Okay, that's a good number. I'm very proud of you guys. All right, so the biggest thing that I have to remind people is know your audience, okay? This is where doing your homework comes in handy and where those job descriptions and what you've paid attention to those job descriptions are really important, okay? Because again, we have to tailor all of these documents to speak to those specific opportunities, okay? Does anybody have questions in regards to any of these major pieces? Because I'm just kind of quickly touching on those. Does everybody have an online platform that they use? LinkedIn, ePortfolio, something of that nature? Perfect. All right, so essentially what I like to do, and just kind of explain foundationally, your resume is essentially only your movie trailer. Your resume is not what gets you the job. Your resume is only intended to get you an interview, okay? So your resume and your beginning documents here are only to impress the employer enough to want to meet you and hear the rest of your story. Okay? So this is where you brag and highlight and you tell them how awesome you are at being a professional. Okay? So all those times where people, again, they're asking you essentially to write down on paper, tell me about yourself. What's the most impressive pieces of information you can share with me in 2 pages? Again, most people have the assumption it's up to 1 page only. You can have up to 2 pages. Now, there are going to be some nuances to industries, whether or not you're going to have more than 2 pages, okay? Who's in the STEM fields? Who's in medical? Research? Higher education? Okay. Those in those fields that I named off, you're going to move into from a resume eventually into what we call a curriculum vitae or a CV. Are you familiar with that is? No. So essentially, it's going to be the story of your professional life. It's going to be a multi-page document. You're going to start adding things like publications and research and presentations and grant funds that you've received and blah, 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 because you're going to have to do additional pieces of your professional steps, right? And you're going to have to be able to showcase that in more than 2 pages. Okay, so for those of you in those fields, if you want to come see me in career services, we can give you samples of what that can look like and kind of what that's going to be moving forward. But as of right now, a standard typical resume should be up to 2 pages. Okay? All right. And again, we're here to the other part that people don't like. How many of you are comfortable going up to somebody and talking to them and telling them about yourself? At a career fair, at an interview, any of that nature? Less hands? Okay. All right, so how many of you are like, man, this kind of makes me nervous, and I'm not really sure what to say? And okay, that's a lot more of us. Okay, I'm in that crowd as well. So part of the issue is, again, we said 80% of people get jobs by who they know. Okay, that's pretty standard information. But that comes down to a lot of people know people, right? You know the people in your class, you know your faculty, but how well do they know you? Do they know you well enough to talk about, hey, John's looking for a job. I know John is great at public speaking. I know John has great training skills. Let me go ahead and talk to this person and tell them about John and how well he can do this job. Okay? then as the employer, I'm going to take more care with, okay, well, this person knows somebody that can be a character reference. I trust your opinion of this person, so let me actually go ahead and pull them in for an interview. Well, your resume may be on a stack of hundreds, but because somebody says they know you and you're great at X, Y, and Z, now I'm going to pull you out of that stack. And your chances of getting seen in an interview are going to be a little bit higher. Okay? So again, it comes back to not just who you know, but who knows you and who's willing to be that helpful network for you. So again, you make friends all day long, but if they're not really willing to help you, what kind of professional friend are they? Okay? So they should be able to help you figure out where to apply, how to apply, where to look, right? So let people know if you're in the stage of job searching. Let everybody you know that you're looking for a job, right? Because those people that you're going to ask to tell you about character traits and what are some of my strengths, they're going to be able to go and share with their friends and their networks and people they know, hey, so-and-so is looking for a job. Do you know anything? So now instead of you just being the only one looking, you're using your network to find other opportunities that you might not even have been aware of just because of who you know and who knows you. Okay? Any questions with networking? All right. So again, lots of different places to look. Career fairs, networking events, memberships and affiliations, and their social gatherings that they have. You can do employer site visit here all the time. You can do employer site visits at their locations. Again, informational interviewing, job shadowings, volunteer. We at ODU have a lot of fellowship opportunities, study abroads, apprentice programs, co-ops, okay? Look into some of those additional opportunities for you to get additional varying experiences outside of just your degrees, okay? Sororities, fraternities, leadership opportunities, like we were talking about, those are great ways for you to gather some of this experience and make friends with people who might be able to help you later on in life, right? All right, and keep in mind, like we said, we don't want just one type of connection. We want a mixture of connections. The interview. Okay, so hopefully through the whole rest of this process, we've now gotten to the point of we're getting the callbacks, right? We're going to get interviews. Please, please, please prepare for your interview. Do not wait till an hour or two before to be printing out those resumes. Don't think the night before, what am I going to wear? Okay? You should know exactly where you're going. You should already have it mapped out or GPSed. You should know exactly what you're going to wear. Okay? Probably get a couple of opinions to make sure it looks appropriate because you've done your homework based on what is their culture and attire. Okay? And, make sure that you are comfortable. Again, have practiced with your five key words of how am I going to describe myself so you're not tripped up by the very first question of tell me about you, okay? Now, also, big thing when we're in an interview, is that the most appropriate time to start talking about how much money you're going to make and what your vacation packages are going to look like and all that great stuff? It's a trick question, guys. Who would say yes? Who has talked about this in an interview? Oh, God, I'm so glad. That's a no-go, okay? Those are negotiation factors. And the interview process is, again, still, we're one of many that we're considering, right? They haven't offered you a job. They haven't said, you're my number one pick just yet. You're in a group collective of potential people. So at this point, none of that applies to you, okay? Now, a lot of times they'll give you a heads up. This is what the pay scale might be, or this is what you might be getting. So you know if we want to continue through this process. However, that is not a time that we discuss in depth most of that information. Okay? Please know what type of interview you're going to be having. Are you going to be in person? Are you going to be over the phone? Do you have to do a virtual recording of yourself? Are you going to have one person interviewing you? Is it going to be a panel? Is it going to be a board? How many people are going to be interviewing? Because how you prepare for that process is going to be very different depending on what we have set up. Okay? Always make sure that you alleviate any distractions. Kids, phones, gum, stuff in your pockets, whatever it is, okay? If you're a fidgeter, be aware that you fidget and try to eliminate anything that's going to put you in that process, okay? Make sure you have questions. This is where I see a lot of people go wrong in this process, is you do all this research, you do all this homework, you go through the process of interviewing, and then the employer says, do you have questions? And you're like, no. I'm just glad I made it through this process. You take that sigh, and then you leave the interview. The problem is the interview is actually structured to be a conversation between you and the employer. It's not an interrogation. They're not there to just ask you 100 questions and make you nervous and then make sure you're lying or not. That's not what it's for. It is genuinely a conversation because they want to get to know you as a person. And if you have no questions, then we've just immediately cut off that conversation. And that doesn't reflect well, right? We basically said, I don't really want to get to know you. I'm just going through the process. So always ask questions. What do you like about your job? How did you get here? Tell me a little bit about what my day-to-day would look like. Because you want to get to know the people you work with. You want to know about that culture, that environment, and whether or not it's really going to be the best fit for you or not. Okay? Now, has everybody heard of the STAR method? No. All right. So on that handout you'll have where it says, what is it? Cracking your career story. We've broken down for you the STAR method, and essentially this is how we prepare responding to the other questions you're going to be asked during the interview. So we practiced the first one, right? So we all should be a little bit more comfortable with tell me about yourself. But now it's how do we answer those questions that are wanting to know how you deal with stress? What do you do in a certain type of environment? What happens if you and your colleague don't get along? Okay? What we call is those are going to be situational behavioral type questions. Again, I want to get to know you as a person. How are you going to behave based on this type of situation? Okay? Because I may need you to run and go tell a supervisor, or I may need you to handle it right here and now based on your problem-solving skills, depending on what they need you to do, right? So, essentially, STAR gets broken down to, as you're answering these questions, give them a setup for what is the scenario? What's the situation? Okay? And it's brief, clear, concise sort of scenario. Ideally, I should be able to picture in my head what's happening, okay? Then I need to know the task. What was your role? What did you do? What are you expected to be happening in this situation? Okay? Then what were the actions taken for that situation? And then ultimately, what was the result or the outcome? Now, typically, we want to phrase this in a way to where we have a positive outcome and everything turned out wonderfully. However, that's not always the case, right? Sometimes the outcome didn't turn out so great. But what they're looking for at that point was, how did you overcome that situation? What did you learn from that situation? Okay, because again, we're human. Not everything we do in life is perfect. Not everything goes right the first time. But what did you learn and how are you going to grow? And if that is approached to you, if that situation you're approached with again, how would you handle it differently? Make sense? Okay. So if you go to the interview and you're ready for, tell me about yourself, give me those five key things, and then you structure the rest of your answers to their questions based on the STAR method, you should have a really good flow for that conversation. And then when you end with the questions, information gathering for yourself about who are they and what are they about and what is the culture of this environment and do I really want to work here? The last piece of that process that tends to trip most people up is that follow-up of what are the next steps. I need everybody in your next interview before you leave to ask them, what's the next step in the process? Because what I find most often is after we get through all this and we ask the questions and it was wonderful to meet you, go to your cars and you breathe and you're like, oh great, I called my mom, this was fabulous. But I don't know what to do now. Should I email them? Am I gonna call them? Do I need to show up next Tuesday? Should I just wait for them to contact me? And then you're left with more anxiety and more questions and they're left with, do they really want this job or not? Okay? Any questions so far on this? If they've already explained to you kind of what their next step is, that's fine, but not all of them include that as part of the ending conversation, okay? Because again, they're trying to assess, do you understand that this is a conversation? And have you provided enough information for them to say, she's comfortable, she gets it? Because, again, a lot of people, their nerves all the way through the process will try and just get the better of them till the end. And then they do forget to ask, are you going to follow up with me, or should I follow up with you, or what do we do now after this? Okay. So if they've given you that, great. If not, be sure to ask. Okay. Absolutely, and that should be part of your research. When you go in, your documents should be directed to a specific person or persons. You should know the name of the people you're going to be interviewing. You should know if it's going to be a panel interview. You should know if it's going to be one-on-one with a hiring manager. This is where your preparation and your research comes in, right? Because we should know the company. We should know who it is we might be connecting with at this point. And that's a great way for when you're having this conversation. Maybe you found out they went to the same university you did. We can talk about being alum at the same university. Or maybe they like the same sports teams you like. That's another easy introduction where I can connect with you, and it's not on a very nerve-wracking place. You know what I mean? Again, I'm putting you in a human perspective. Okay? So it is helpful, absolutely. And I highly encourage you to do your homework on who it is you're trying to interview and connect with. Great questions. Anybody else? All right, so hopefully after we've gotten through all these steps, we should be at the accepting the offer, or we may be at having to reject the offer, okay? But this is where we go back to discussing those compensation details, okay? Once they've offered the position to you, now we consider these negotiating points, okay? If you need more money, ask for more money. If you want vacation time, talk about vacation time, okay? This is where we can negotiate the rest of our deal. Take time to consider the offer, okay? Because again, it comes down to more than just doing a job. Are you going to be happy there? Are you going to be successful there? Is there room for growth? Is this really where you want to be, or did you just take the job because it was the first one that gave you the chance? Okay, so take some time to consider. You got to make sure you're making realistic transition plans, especially if you're moving from one thing to the other, or if you have to travel or relocate, or you're gonna take a pay and cut, or you have kids or family that you have to consider based on schedulings and times and that sort of thing. Okay, so understand how all those other pieces connect together. Make sure you're reviewing the employee handbook, find out what the dress codes are, any sort of holidays, vacation things, okay? So anything else that's gonna impact your day-to-day, make sure you're reviewing their information. Really make sure you understand the organization, the roles, the relationships, and how you're going to be connected. And then go ahead and accept and begin the new job. Or, again, if it's not working out, understand that we're going to have to start the process all over. But hopefully by now you have friends, you know all the pieces, you know all the steps, you know you have career services available to you. So use your supports and your networks so the next time the process isn't as lengthy and isn't as complicated, because now you know what you're dealing with, right? And you have people to help and support you get through it. And that's that. All right, guys. Questions, thoughts, comments? Feeling a little bit better? Go for it.
Just as far as like events go to help us find the companies and stuff to apply to, are there any like additional mailing lists or anything available just to help us keep better track of those and to be made aware of those things that we might otherwise miss?
So as a student and even as an alumni for ODU, we do have a free online tool called Careers for Monarchs. Okay, you can have access to that. We do have our online job board. It does let you know when we have events and opportunities where employers will be connecting with us. So keep contacted with our office, and basically what we have set up for you, we can connect you with for that. Plus, there are other opportunities. LinkedIn, you can job search. There's a lot of them out there, especially depending on your industry. We also have liaisons, depending on what program you're in. They can kind of help direct you to where you can search and what might be available based on your industry or your need. So, yes, if you do have questions of where to look, please come see us, and we can kind of help tailor that for you. Any other questions?
Degree works also helps with what if.
Yes. Absolutely. DegreeWorks is also a wonderful place to look. Our personal website for Career Development Services also has additional resources and lists. So check that out as well. So, great. All right, guys. Well, you're free. That's all I got for you. And if you would like us to send you any information, do we have your...
Yeah, so I have your emails if you sign
Perfect.
In. And if you didn't sign in yet, just stop back here and
yes.
wait out and we'll swipe them for
you. Right. And if you want us to send you any more information or want to schedule appointments, please feel free to come do so. All right, guys. Bye. Thanks for coming.
Thank
you. You're so welcome.
Yeah,
go for it.
So what I'm doing right now, like applying to Carter for Monash or LinkedIn, like whatever I see. So some of them like transfer me to their website, like company website,
right.
I log in, I apply.
Mm-hmm.
So that's done. Like so you know to follow up, like to so I have been searching them on the LinkedIn. So like how am I supposed to like talk to them?
Like reconnect. So basically, ideally, what they're trying to do is LinkedIn and some of these other things are like third-party recruiters. So because they have so many opportunities, they're trying to have other people help gather candidates. But if they're directing you to their site, then go back to their site because their website is based on their company itself. So if you go to the contact us, you can contact our HR person or whoever answers the phone. They can let you know who you need to speak to. For the position and that sort of thing.
So I email them like I have applied for the position or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And what about like career from when I like there's a contact person as well and like.
So because we would be considered a third party, basically employers connect with us. We just house their information, but ideally for you to get the job, you have to go through them. Okay. So yes, we help share some of that information and make the process a little bit easier for you based on who we've connected with as employers. But ideally, they still want you to deal with them for the actual job.
Yeah, even career for Monax, either you can directly apply, like upload your resume, CV,
yes.
and apply,
yes.
or they link you to the company.
Right.
So again, I come back and like contact the HR person, like
yes.
I applied and.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if like directs me to the company website, I apply through it, like and do
yes.
everything.
Yes.
Then I like search for the company itself, like not on LinkedIn.
Yes, because again, we're just another way to get you to that same information.
Yeah.
If they want you to apply on their website, then that's essentially where we're going to send you anyway, because that's where they're collecting their applicants.
Okay.
Okay. Great question. Thank you for coming. Yes, ma'am.
All graduates.
Do you have a Career for Monarchs account?
I do.
Okay. Have you utilized it very often?
No, not really.
Okay.
It's hard for me. Like, it's not really user-friendly in my life.
Okay. Absolutely. So what you can do is you can come by. We can kind of show you Careers for Monarchs. We can look for other places. What program are you in?
Information technology.
Okay. If you go to the front desk office, they can give you a little handout for who your liaison would be.
Mm-hmm.
They can help kind of guide and direct you based on your program, opportunities that might be available more for your field. Because for us, we try to deal in generalizations for all students, whereas they kind of tailor specifics to each program that's available.
Okay.
So as a graduate student for IT, you might want to check with your liaison, because again, they're going to connect you with employers that they're familiar with and
right.
there's opportunities.
Okay, I do have a question on campus.
So on campus, our office deals with, do you have just a work study?
So
the federal work study?
She can
set up
a review.
But I work on campus.
Or you can also come
okay.
in and have a general
so
review.
So essentially, it's going to be the same sort of process
okay.
that you went through before for any on campus
job.
The only thing with that is we only list based on what we're told in the Career for Honors account. So for us, that's kind of our one stop shop outside of dealing with liaisons for
resume review,
kind of basic search engines,
say
jobs.
You know, you
can
ask emails or your resume or.
But yeah, go stop by the office and maybe they hand out for who your liaison's going to be and help you out.
That's the one for front line.
Yeah.
So what was your major?
Accounting.
Okay.
Oh, did you? Yes,
I have.
Perfect. Thank you. Good.
So you can either come into our Joplin Center or you can meet with one of our college liaisons. They're more specific to your college, so you would want to meet.